Hello everyone, welcome to the FameLab UK 2017 final. Yes indeed, that is very exciting. Now we're your hosts tonight, my name's John, his name's Sam. We don't have last names, that's
don't
all the information that you need to know. Now we're very excited because this is the first time that we've had the UK FameLab final at the Science Museum. They're very easily pleased. That's a very good sign.
That won't last. Now, who's been to a FameLab before? Give us a cheer. There we go. If you haven't, if you've just wandered off the street, FameLab is a is an international competition. It's a good start. International competition to find kind of the next big names in science communication. It's a booming landscape. So FameLab finalists have gone on to be TV presenters, TED talkers, and we're hoping one of the 10 finalists here tonight will go on to that kind of superstardom level. And they'll go on to the international final at the Cheltenham Science Festival.
So the UK competition actually involved 350 scientists across the country. There were 25 regional heats, including one here at the Science Museum. And they've been whittled down to just 10 finalists, which you'll be meeting tonight. I'm loving this whooping and cheering. I mean, it doesn't seem to be at appropriate points, but it's great.
So the final will be at the Cheltenham Science Festival. It will be in June, and it's an international final that's going to be in Cheltenham Science Festival in June. There'll be people from across the world, countries such as Brazil.
Wow.
India.
Wow.
Australia.
They're not getting whoops. Why are they not getting whoops?
I'll keep going until one does. Thailand! They love Thailand, I'll stop there. All around the world, and we tonight will find out who's going to represent the UK at that international final. Very, very exciting, John.
Now, the contestants do need to be judged, and it won't be us doing it. We have proper judges tonight. Please put your hands together for Roger Highfield, Lewis Dartnell, and Rathi Prasad. Let's get evaluating. They are the cream of the crop of the science communication world. Now, they will be evaluating on content, clarity, and charisma because they like alliteration.
Oh, yes.
Who doesn't? Are you feeling up to the task, guys?
Yes.
Yes. Gulp.
After everyone does their kind of 3 minutes, you will have 2 minutes as well to ask questions, grill them a bit, and find out any more information that you might require. So I think that's about it. I think, are we ready for our first contestant?
Yeah.
Okay. So our first contestant is a PhD biochemistry student from the University of Bath. Please give a massive round of applause for contestant number one, Mr. Alex Lathbridge.
What's good, FameLab? So, what rhymes with epilepsy? Pepsi? Narcolepsy? Alex, you're looking very sexy. No, yes, no. In the UK, where we've got 600,000 people with epilepsy, that's 1 in 100, and this IMAX fits 400, so I'm looking for at least 4 more for my boy band. What rhymes with epilepsy is a 76-year-old woman. Yes, now this woman, she presented with seizures after going to the doctor and getting medication for it. She presented with hypergraphia, so that's compulsive writing. But she did it in the form of poetry, and no one really knows why. Was it due to the seizures? Was it due to the medication, or a mixture of both? Unsure. And that case study really sets a story for what we understand about epilepsy. A lot, but not a whole lot. Way in the past, it was seen as the disease of the holy. These people were having seizures and speaking to God, so they were revered. More recently, it's been people who are unclean or invaded by spirits, and so they should be destroyed. What I'm saying is there's a lot of misunderstanding on both sides of the spectrum. But what really is it? Well, I'm going to get explicit. It's a condition meaning that your brain, it might fire on synchronized rhythms. And you're probably wondering, Alex, why is rhythm bad? You know, people say I need more rhythm in my life. Well, when it comes to the nervous system, one thing is fundamental. It's that every potential action, it requires an action potential. just call it a nerve impulse, but it's just the consequence of neural membrane ion exchange, because you get a resulting difference that depolarizes and repolarizes your neurons. What? Okay, like a Mexican wave, charge, it falls and rises and then carries on again, because each of your neurons, it relays an electrical message and then it gets to rest for like a millisecond. And that could be for anything from lifting a cup to tapping your head while doing the weird belly rub. But when you're having a seizure, you're not feeling like a winner, because your brain, it starts firing in patterns like angry synchronized swimmers. Normally, you're walking and talking. Your brain, neurons are firing off, sort of like random. But when you're having a seizure, clustering starts a pattern. So normally, walking, talking, doing things, it can be described sort of something like... But when you're having a seizure, it's hypersynchronous neuronal activity at some point in the brain. So it's more like... And that's what leads to the seizure. It's not really useful information in your body. You just start having a seizure. But what gives you epilepsy? Well, it can be genetic or acquired. I'll start with the former, then I'll move to the latter. It's required. Because sometimes these seizures, they reflect a single gene defect causing neuronal upset, or else it can be more indirect, like a stuntman who hits his head internally bled with no O2 fed, because normally in the UK, one of the reasons is due to stroke or tumours, this brain damage. Okay, what leads to seizures? Well, yeah, you're kind of right, but there are other triggers apart from flashing lights, low blood sugar, maybe high stress, or really any imbalance in what's in your head. Okay, I've got some time over. I've got some science over, but I've got some time left. There is one more thing I think I need to address. You can say brainstorm. We don't get offended. There is one thing I need. It needs to be appended. If you see someone having a seizure, put them in the recovery position. Just sit and don't stick anything in their mouth. They can't swallow this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alex. Very well done. Judges, your 2 minutes of questions, please.
Thank you, Alex, for that lovely, lovely talk. I very much enjoyed that. And I was fascinated by the example you gave of the woman with epilepsy, and it presented itself with her outpourings of poetry and creative writing. Are there other examples of that kind of effect, where someone has suffered epilepsy and they just nail some kind of creative activity?
Well, some people think that some forms of epilepsy can lead to sort of this savant syndrome. So, again, she had temporal lobe epilepsy, so this part of the brain, and that can damage, sort of change there can lead to these sorts of things, like some people have said, sort of savant syndrome. But what's really interesting, when you say that, like these seizures in the brain, different parts of the brain, it can lead to things like auras, which are sort of like just previously, before you have a seizure, you can start, in some cases, people start hearing things. And that's, I think, quite interesting, because it all depends on different parts of the brain that have the seizure. It's quite cool.
I really like your sort of rapping, poetic...
Thanks, man.
..delivery, which is... I went to the very first FameLab final. I've never heard that kind of delivery before, which is great. And you study cancer pathways in the body.
Yeah.
But you chose epilepsy, yeah. Presumably, is there greater rapping potential in epilepsy?
Yeah, that, and I have epilepsy. So it's a personal thing for me, because like epilepsy is one of those things, like I mentioned, it's 500,000 to 600,000 people in the UK have it. And so chances are someone in this room knows someone who's been affected by it. And because it's one of those hidden diseases, like it's medicated, right? People have medication for it, and that can control the seizures. But like 33% of people don't respond, like aren't controlled by their medication. And so they've got their life to lead. So I think being able to talk about this in front of all of these wonderful people and having them go out and go, oh, hey man, I learned something new about epilepsy. Do you want to talk about it? That might be, you know, that might be great. I thought, thank you.
Very entertaining, Alex. I see why you were speaking about epilepsy. Can you do the same for maths, computers, and small proteins to target cancer? Do you talk about a lot of different topics?
I mean, what rap about it? Or just talk about
be
it?
Be as entertaining with it. Do you talk about a lot of issues at events like this?
So you want to talk about my work?
Want to talk about your work, yeah.
Okay, so I work on something called coiled coils, right? And so these are two little proteins you can bring together, and they can form these transcription factors. I'm shying away from calling it what's called in nomenclature the type of packing. It's called knobs into holes packing. So I'm shying, I realize this might be the one place to say it. And so if you think of like a handshake coming together, this is how this transcription factor forms. So it binds, it's a molecule that binds to the DNA and controls certain genes being upregulated, downregulated. And the ones we're looking at are ones that have an effect on cancer pathways. So sort of like whenever Donald Trump gives a handshake, something bad happens. So we want to stop that from happening. So I come in with what I've designed, a sort of a RoboCop hand that I've designed computationally and then built. And then we go, okay, yep, no, we're going to shake your hand, make sure you can't do anything. And that's what I do.
Hmm. In, okay, in the 3 years of my PhD on transcription factors, I wish I had the opportunity again to write about knobs and holes and
tracks. So your two eyes lit up with glee. Yeah.
We were taking notes.
Well, that is all the time we've got for questions, I'm afraid. Ladies and gentlemen,
thanks, Alex.
Massive round of applause for Alex.
So now it is time for contestant number two. Anna is a material scientist and engineer in the final year of her PhD at UCL. Please put your hands together for Anna Porszajski.
It's the summer of 2011. The London riots are in full swing. The final Harry Potter movie has just come out and Cher Lloyd is number one. Yeah, me neither. I am sitting in the back of a Chevrolet 4x4 pickup truck, squashed in between five very sweaty Scottish car mechanics in the middle of the sweltering Utah desert. We are trying to break the land speed record. We're here on the salt flats, and the reason we're in this car is the fact that we are trying to will the tiny, tiny green speck on the horizon to go faster, because we're trying to break a land speed record. Now, my role on this team is chief materials engineer. This means that whenever any of the engines break, which is all the time, it's my job to find out why. Now, on the first day, our driver, Rick, is going at like 250 miles an hour, and he hears a bang from the engine. He steers it to the side, and we take the car back to the pits to open it up and see what had happened. Now, as a materials engineer, I'm sort of like a forensic pathologist, but for dead cars instead of dead people. And I've seen my fair share of fractured materials, but this particular engine post-mortem was particularly graphic. The gearbox was completely shredded, all right? It was just reduced to glitter floating in engine oil. But out of this, I pick up two gear cogs, which had come out whole. Now, I turn these over in my hand, and the first thing that I notice is that one of them has a sort of dull, mottled fracture surface, which is where it had originally attached to the main cogwheel. Now, I know immediately that this has undergone ductile fracture. Ductile fracture is like what happens when you break a Snickers bar. The material bends and flows before it breaks. But this was the weird thing. The second gear cog had a shiny, flat fracture surface. WTF, I said to myself. How can these two cogs made of exactly the same material have broken off in such different ways? Well, the answer lies with the speed at which they broke off, because if you take a Snickers bar, chocolate has got a lot smaller, hasn't it, recently? If you take a Snickers bar and you break it fast enough, the molecules in it don't have time to bend around each other and to flow over each other. And so the material just snaps. Thank you very much.
Anna! Okay, judges, you have 2 minutes to question Anna if you wish.
Was the trip to Utah, was it a part of your
research. No, I did this as an undergrad, and this has got absolutely nothing to do with the research that I've actually gone on to do. I work on hydrogen storage composites. So I work on how you can store hydrogen, which is usually a gas, into a solid material, and that's for portable applications. So that's like for cars or for drones or even personal devices like phones and laptops. And the benefit of this is that hydrogen is usually a gas. And so to store it in a gas cylinder, that's quite a good way to store it, but these gas cylinders are quite big and bulky. So the materials that I work with store hydrogen in a much smaller volume, and that has all sorts of benefits.
Do you find your topic particularly difficult to talk about, because of the real-world context, do you find it?
My research topic? Mm-hmm, yeah. So the first ever sort of public engagement thing I did was talking about my research topic. I spoke about hydrogen storage and online dating. That's really the only funny thing that I can find about hydrogen storage. Actually, speaking of online dating, these two are the actual gear cogs that came out of the car, and you can have a little look at those. I actually take these sometimes on first dates to just in case there's any like lapse in conversation. So weird that I'm still single.
I would have thought surely your snack Snickers trick is quite a good.
More impressive.
I feel quite tempted to snap a Snicker.
I've got some. Do you want?
Yeah. We'll do that afterwards. Okay. Actually. But one thing I want to ask you, though, are you anything to do with the Bloodhound? Is this the Bloodhound land speed record?
So the Bloodhound does race at the Bonneville Speed Races in Utah, but they're going for the overall land speed record. Our particular vehicle category was a 1 litre motorbike engine streamliner car. So the driver sort of sits in it, like lying down. And that was our particular category. During that week, we unfortunately didn't get the land speed record for that, and it actually hasn't been beaten since. So then it was at 313 miles an hour, and it still stands there. We got like 270, which is not bad, but then the engines kept breaking. So,
so just quickly, both these teeth are off the same cog that obliterates itself.
We think so,
itself.
Yes.
So why is it that one of them fractured ductilely, and the other word, which I've forgotten, but it sounded quite techy?
Brittle.
Brittle. So, I'm a biologist. So how is it two Snickers bars on the same cog,
right,
in very, very different ways?
Excellent question.
Uh-huh.
So we think what happened...
Last one, Mark.
We think what happened is that the first cog, which came off with ductile fracture, the sort of gentle, slow one, that probably came off first. It then whipped around inside the gearbox, and then slammed into that other one, and so it shattered it with much greater force and much quicker. Obviously, most of our cars don't have this problem, so why did it happen? Well, I said that it was a 1 litre motorbike engine. These engines are not designed to withstand these sorts of forces and withstand these sorts of loads. So what probably happened was, if you look on the edges of those, they're black, and all gear cogs tend to be case-hardened, and that means... The steel material has had carbon infiltrated into it. Steel doesn't really like to have carbon infiltrated into it, but the effect of it is that the case is much harder. But what can happen is this carbon over time, because it prefers to be next to itself in the structure rather than next to an iron atom, what happens is it tends to clump together, and these clumps can then form a source of stress in the structure, which is where some cracks can start to form. So probably what happened is the carbon had lumped up over time, and that formed a crack, which then busted the gear.
That is your 2 minutes up, I'm afraid, so we're going to have to move on to the next contestant. Give a big round of applause to Anna Porcelowski.
Thank you.
So we don't give a contestant extra time.
Absolutely.
So next up, we have test number 3. It's going to be Callum Davidson. He's a cardiovascular scientist studying at the University of Edinburgh. And so we'll see if he gets your hearts racing tonight. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Callum Davidson.
Hi, everyone. Thanks very much for the introduction. There was one fairly major error, however. Callum can't actually be here this evening. Sorry to disappoint. I'm here as a replacement. My name is Corti. That's short for cortisol. Unlike Callum, who's an unimportant human man, I'm an extremely important stress hormone, probably the major stress hormone in the human body. Now, despite my importance, I suspect most of you don't know much about me. Well, that's all about to change. Now, I'm a busy hormone, I've got 3 minutes, so let's get straight to business, shall we? I'm here to stress to you the importance of not stressing, okay? And you know why I need to do that? Because when you stress, I'm the one that has to go to work. And all that work starting to make me feel pretty stressed. Let me start by talking you through a standard 9-to-5 day in the office for cortisol. One of you gets stressed. That starts as a signal in the head office. Sorry, that's the hypothalamus in your brain. That signal is then wired via your pituitary gland down to my offices in the adrenal glands, just on top of the kidneys. Now, I share this office with the world-famous adrenaline, a cocky little hormone who's built up a brand for himself as the fight-or-flight hormone. He gets to be first on the scene during stress, okay? Making your heart pound, your airways open up, and your pupils dilate. These things are all great short-term preparation, but someone's got to have their eye on the long game, and that's my job, okay? I'm out in the bloodstream just after facilitating the slower effects of stress. Now, travel is a major perk of my job, one of the few. I get to work in most major organs, okay? So, for example, I'm in your liver, breaking down energy stores just to build up blood glucose for those muscles of yours. I'm in your kidneys and your blood vessels, where I raise blood pressure to help your heart pump out more blood faster. I suppress inflammation in case you get injured whilst you're stressed. And I'm in your gonads, where I inhibit reproductive function, because sex isn't going to help you solve a stressful problem. Okay, I do all these things because I'm trying to help you, okay? Adrenaline and I, we evolved so that your prehistoric ancestors could escape from predators. I don't know if you've noticed, but there's not that many predators around nowadays. And in fact, most of you are more at risk from your own psychosocial stresses. I'm talking about things like worrying about your workload, your bank balance, or your relationship status. All these things mean that I am having to work overtime. And like anyone else, when I'm overworked, I start to make mistakes. So for example, if I'm raising your blood sugar the whole time, you're going to be at risk of diabetes, and I'm going to get hate mail from insulin, who works over in the pancreas. If I'm forever raising your blood pressure, that's going to put strain on your heart and your vessels, isn't it? Oh, don't even get me started on the problem I cause in your gonads. Trust me, stress hormones are a buzzkill in the bedroom. So all I'm saying is, next time you feel yourself getting stressed, spare a thought for the stress hormones and relax. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Callum. Judges, it's over to you.
So, Callum or Courty, I'm still struggling with the thought in either character. Gonads. I mean, you know, I might have to lie down. But you study cardiovascular research. So, is that the inspiration? Are you looking at cortisol and the effect on the heart, or is it just you thought, oh my God, I've got to do FameLab and that's really stressful, I'll just, you know, live
it? Yeah, it certainly served a twin purpose. So my research is based around stress hormones, but also this was an incredibly stressful experience in the build-up to it, so I thought I could channel that energy usefully. But yeah, my research is looking at the ways we can actually, something I didn't mention in my talk, is that stress hormones, when they reach your tissues, can actually be turned on or off by specific enzymes, and so we think maybe if we can play around with those enzymes, we could sort of alter the balance of stress hormones that reach your tissues.
And so it's an interesting point in modern life that this machinery that had a very serious purpose 50,000 years ago is just firing off inappropriately for all sorts of reasons, and what you're interested in, drugs to deal with that and so on.
Largely, yeah. I mean, there's actually a huge amount of effects that stress hormones have on your body. A lot of them positive, some of them negative. I mean, to talk about my work specifically, we know that stress hormones stop new blood vessels from growing. So this is something I didn't talk about in my talk, but they stop blood vessels from growing. So if you can prevent the amount of stress hormones that reach a tissue, you might be able to make more blood vessels grow. Now, in some contexts, that would be a good thing. For example, if you've had a heart attack or something like that, new blood vessels is a good thing. It helps you recover blood flow to that tissue. But those same drugs could have quite a negative effect in something like cancer, for example, where new blood vessels are going to help a tumor grow more quickly. Right. So that's my research.
We don't usually get to anthropomorphize.
It's got to be a very quick question here.
You know, I mean, it's great. I like the way you described the hormones as working colleagues. And how did you come up with this method of delivery very quickly in 3 seconds?
1 second. I think that playing a part and giving us like a kind of science and narrative helps people take it in more, because you can remember Courtney's story, hopefully, now, which will remind you of specific points about your
He's
your
in your gonads.
Yeah, I'm in your gonads.
And that's, if you that's don't where we have to stop.
I'm in your gonads.
So it's time for contestant number 4. It's Swansea's very own Dr. Carol Glover. Carol is a material scientist specialising in corrosion. So let's see if her enthusiasm for rust wears off on us.
Very much in the delivery, mostly.
I did not write that. just want to be 100% clear on that. Please welcome to the stage Dr. Carol Glover.
At the car wash this weekend, and whilst browsing their selection of novelty air fresheners, I was rudely interrupted by the sound of two men arguing. One of them had this to say: "Oh, you've damaged my car. You're going to have to pay for that." Well, being naturally curious, I went over to see what all the fuss was, and like an old friend, I recognised the damage instantly. And I couldn't help myself. I said to the yelling man, "You have worms on your wheel." And he said, "You what?" And I said, "Worms. Filiform worms. Filiform corrosion worms. On your wheel?" My guess is, around 4 months ago, you did a spot of shoddy parking and damaged the paintwork. To which he replied, "They were only a scratch." Well, every corrosion scientist knows it's never just a scratch. So I told him, when you damage the paintwork, you expose the underlying metal to electrolyte, like rainwater or any aqueous solution containing electrically conducting species. And when that happens, you get an electrochemical corrosion cell. And your wheel is riddled. He made that noise again. And then he asked me, "What do you know?" Well, I could spare a minute, so I told him more. In the head of each one of these worms, two reactions take place. At the lead edge, an anodic reaction dissolves the metal, forming corrosion product, known in casual circles as rust. It's an oxidation reaction, so it loses electrons and they flow from the front of the head to the back of the head, where they're taken by a cathodic reduction reaction, combining with oxygen and water to complete the electrochemical corrosion cell. I noticed he was looking a little bit angry, but I think he just had one of those faces, you know, miserable. So I carried on. Oxygen from the atmosphere diffuses through the worm's tail, replenishing the cathodic reaction and driving the electrochemical corrosion cell forward until the entire wheel is engulfed. "So you see, good sir," I said, "this man didn't damage your car. It was bloody you all along. And remember, it's never just a scratch." Thank you.
Okay, judges, your 2 minutes of questions.
Thanks very, very much for that, Carol. I loved that dramatic performance.
You
were really pulling me along in the story, and I was gagging to hear what was coming up next. The question I had is, now that we understand about the cathodic and anodic electrochemistry going on, can we apply that knowledge in different ways? So
yes.
I guess this is now linking into your direct research
yeah,
as to how we can stop people's wheels falling off, or I guess ships and things
where
it's a big issue
well,
as well.
So many applications. And the key is that every single metal corrodes in slightly different ways, and in different scenarios they corrode in different ways, so it's really important that we understand everything, and just for our own personal interest, but also so that we can then design coatings and other protection methods. So it's really important to understand that fundamental science.
I was thinking that I would listen to any story you tell, really. But why is it important that engineers connect with the public and being able to tell stories about engineering?
Well, it's really important because we're funded, partly by industry in my case, but partly by the public. It's really important that they know what we're doing and understand how it helps society. In my local area, we have a steel plant right by the university, and so it's quite a hot topic there. But it's also really important to get feedback from the public so we can constantly check that it's relevant and people understand what we're doing, they know where their money is being spent and whether they think it's worthwhile for society.
I think even arguments at garages.
You're incredibly brave tackling corrosion, though.
It took me 2 years
to come up with
that.
That's a slightly unprepossessing subject. Yeah. So you're kind of corrosion evangelist. Weren't you tempted to try something a bit easier and a bit...
I liked the challenge of this, yeah. So hopefully it paid off. Everyone's excited now.
And that is your 2 minutes up. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
Give Dr. Carol Glover another massive round of applause.
So we have reached a halfway point, and next up, all the way from Plymouth, we have a neurosurgical junior doctor and entrepreneur here to amaze you. Please raise the roof for Dr. Daniel Alaya!
Hands up anybody who's heard of the Brown sound theory before. It's a subsonic sound wave frequency that when you hear it initiates neural and structural mechanisms that causes involuntary defecation. In other words, it makes you poo yourself. Who wants to try it? Some of you are looking pretty uncomfortable. I saw you. That's because that was pretty weird. But the point is, sound is powerful. It's powerful. It's so, so powerful. I'm sure some of you can smell that by now. But for medical doctors, sound is vital because in the form of ultrasound, we can see inside the body. By shooting high-frequency sound pulses into the body, we can build a picture of the body and what's inside the body based on how the sound bounces into the body, off the tissues, and back into the probe. For me, and for many others, we think of medicine like a war. We're at war. Cancer is one of the big boss baddies. And to destroy cancer, we need to do two things. We need the power to kill it, and we need the vision to see it. The first weapon in our armory is surgery, slicing, dicing, and cutting whatever it is out. But the problem is you bleed a lot. You need anesthetic, and lungs and your heart really don't like anesthetic, and the surgeon might cut out the wrong kidney. Believe me, it happens. The second weapon in our armory is chemotherapy. Pumping medication into the body to seek out and find those cancer cells and to trigger cell death. But the problem is these medications are toxic. It's like sending a nuclear bomb into the body, into a city, but destroying a whole country instead and leaving damage forever. That's where sound comes into the equation. No, not like that. I'm talking about MRG FUS, magnetic resonance image guided focus ultrasound. No needles, no stitching, no knives, no anesthetic, no bleeding, just sound. Focused ultrasound is like using a magnifying glass to focus sunlight on a target to heat it up. It uses an acoustic lens to focus multiple beams of ultrasound on a target. Each beam of ultrasound has a little effect, but the point where they focus on that point, it releases energy in the form of heat, and that destroys that tissue in a process called coagulative necrosis. Magnetic resonance image guided focus ultrasound is so mind-bogglingly amazing. You can use it for many, many different medical applications. So the next time someone asks you, what's all the fuss about? You tell them, the fuss is about MRG fuss. I'm done.
Oh, yeah, very very affecting that. Thank you very much for that. Judges, over to you.
So you're a medical medical technology entrepreneur. And what is it that you do as an entrepreneur? Is it using this ultrasound, or is it something else completely different from your research or from your work?
Thank you for the question.
can you even say that phrase? I guess you've had more practice than I have.
Before being a medical entrepreneur, a medical doctor, that's how I define myself. You know, I enjoy clinical practice, and that's what I do, that's who I am. Being an entrepreneur is a side thing, and what we're focusing on now is nothing to do with ultrasound. Focused ultrasound is just an amazing thing that I think we should push. What we're working on is virtual reality assisted medical education, which is amazing. All of you should look it up. that's what we're working on. Focused ultrasound is the reason why I'm talking about focused ultrasound is because it can be used in many, many different medical applications. So cancer is just one thing we're talking about, but it could be used in hypertension, it could be used in Parkinson's, it could be used in neonatal medicine, many, many different applications.
And tell me about the resolution. I mean, you know, how finely can you sort of, you know, what's the smallest thing you can zap, and what's the deepest thing you can zap as well? Because I can imagine, I mean, I notice you're a neurosurgical junior doctor, so does that mean you could do brain surgery with it or something like that?
So with focused ultrasound, you can reach anywhere in the body. It's currently used for fibroids, which is the deepest part of the body for women. It's currently used in the brain. It's currently used in the prostate. So you can reach any part of the body, and it's so precise that you can actually sign your name in people's bodies with the...
I presume you've done that, haven't you?
don't tell the GMC.
Senior surgeon, Dr. Vicks.
So many applications that we want to talk about. I'm afraid that is it, 2 minutes. Thank you for giving us such confidence in surgeons as well. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Wow. So we are going to be sticking with a medical theme for our next finalist, who is a forensic consultant psychiatrist. And she's determined to lend her expertise to challenging the stigma around mental illness. So please welcome Dr. Joanne Parry.
Science Lates, we need to talk. We need to talk about suicide. Suicide, by definition, is the act of intentionally ending your own life. And every year in the UK, over 6,000 people commit suicide, and tens of thousands more make attempts. The reason why we use the term commit suicide is because it's actually illegal in the UK to try and kill yourself up until 1961. Reversely, should you fail, then punishable by law. Suicide is the leading cause of death for the majority of the audience here today. Young men, aged between 20 and 34, who are four times more likely to kill themselves than their age-matched female counterparts. There are lots of reasons why men are more likely to kill themselves, but one of the reasons is that, sadly, we still tell our young boys and men to man up and hide how they feel and not talk. There are other reasons, such as men being more likely to be alcohol dependent and also choosing more lethal methods, such as hanging versus overdose in females. There's no one reason why someone chooses to end their own life, but there are risk factors which increase your chances. For example, growing up in care, a history of trauma or abuse, having a family member kill themselves, being in prison, being gay, being transgendered. Over a third of our transgender community will attempt to kill themselves at some point in their life. Standing here today as a psychiatrist in front of you, we can't avoid the impact of mental health, and over 90% of suicide completees have some form of mental disorder. So that's fine, isn't it? Because I'm going to see them and look after them and keep them safe. Well, sadly not, because the majority don't go and see any health professional like myself or their GP in the time leading up to their death. But they do see all of you, their friends, their families, they're your brothers, your sisters. Science tells us that in the brain stems and spinal fluid of suicide completers, 5-HT or serotonin, the happy chemical, is lowered. So why don't we just measure that? Well, that's complicated, and actually, they're already dead by then. So what can we do? Six simple words. Ask, have you thought about killing yourself if you're worried about someone? And if they say yes, what do you do? You can take them to the GP, to A&E, to their local crisis team. Get charities, such as Heads Together or Papyrus. There's people out there who want to help you get better. It's okay not to be okay. We need to look after each other. And finally, why the six? Well, sadly, in the time it's taken for me to walk onto the stage today, and by the time I finish talking to you, six lives will have been lost around the world due to suicide. Science Lates, please, I urge you, it's time we all start talking about suicide. Thank you for listening, and please look after each other. It's okay to talk. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Joanne.
Hiya.
Judges, your 2 minutes for questions.
Thank you, Joanna. Is trying to get people to talk what motivated you to talk about this area specifically?
Yeah, I think there's so much stigma out there about mental illness. And yes, there's lots of things recently, you know, with the marathon and with kind of the royal family getting involved. People are starting to talk and celebrities are starting to talk. But really, there is so much stigma behind it. And it's so true of, you know, I see in the families of my patients of when someone gets diagnosed with cancer, everyone rushes round and it's all flowers and chocolates and everyone helping. Someone gets told their son's got schizophrenia and no one comes to the door.
How do you deal with the shame? Because it's probably a personal sense of I'm not supposed to talk about this.
I think we just need to start talking about it. It's okay to talk about. And, you know, we know that by asking people if they're going to kill themselves, you're not going to put the idea in their head. You're not going to increase their chances. People worry about that. That's one of the reasons why I say, I don't want to ask. I don't want to put the idea in their head. You won't. But you do open that life-saving dialogue that gives them the chance to then go and seek help.
Is this a British thing? I mean, is it you know, the stiff upper lip, we shouldn't talk about these things, or is this actually quite a universal?
You know, suicide is a global problem. I think, personally, within the UK, we do have this problem of, you know, we do tell our boys to man up, and it's, you know, as you say, the British upper lip of we don't talk about how I feel, we just soldier on. And, you know, we all hurt and we all have bad days. We should talk about it. There's no, you know, there should be no difference in talking about how you're feeling with your mental health than telling your friends that you went to the dentist not to have a tooth pulled. There's no difference. It's just that we ourselves have that shame, if you like, to talking about it. And it's not a shameful thing. No one asks for mental health problems.
You work at a secure hospital.
I do, yes.
And so do you really get are there anecdotes where you feel if friends and family had asked the question? I mean, they're in a controlled setting there, but would it still make a difference?
I think regardless of, you know, secure settings versus insecure just in mental health, you get lots of families that turn around to you and say, I've been worried for years. You know, at that party, he was that estranged. He wasn't coming out of his bedroom. We were worried. No one wanted to say anything. We hoped it was a phase. You know, there's people like myself that's jobs are to talk to you and to listen and to help. And I just think it's a real shame for families and for patients that nobody seeks that help. It's there, and it's really important that we use that resource.
That's it. That's all our question time there. Thank you very much for that. Let's give another round of applause for Dr. Joanne Parry.
Okay, so on to contestant number 7, who is an anatomy lecturer at Hole York Medical School. So please, ladies and gentlemen, clap your upper limbs together for Kat Sanders!
Have you ever wanted to learn more about your own body? There's a hell of a lot of stuff going on just underneath your skin. We've got dozens of organs, 206 bones, more than 600 muscles, and all the little bits that hold it together. If you study anatomy, there are thousands of structures that not only do you need to be able to locate, but you've also got to give them a name. And the language of anatomy is extensive. In fact, if you study anatomy, you will learn enough new words that you could learn French instead. How overwhelming is that? And to add on to that, it's confusing because anatomical terms are all Latin and Greek-based, and you start to sound like you're reciting spells from Harry Potter. We've got orbicularis oculi, or perhaps you might prefer, honestly, Ronald, it's levator scapulae, not levator scapulae. All I need is a wand. So how can we cut through the confusion and make this language of anatomy seem less daunting? Well, there are two tricks that I like to use. One is to break down the word into its component parts and relate that back to the structure. And the other is to tell a good story. So I'll give you an example of both, starting with gastrocnemius. Now, your gastrocnemius is the big bulging muscle in the back of your calf. And we can break the word down into three parts. We've got gastro, knee, and meus. Now, gastro means belly. You're all here tonight at the Science Museum for the food and drink themed event, so I'm sure there's a few foodies in the audience who may have been to a gastro pub before. And if you have, you would have walked out with a belly bulging with food. And it does, it stands out. Bulging belly in the back of the knee. And knee, well, when gastrocnemius contracts, it flexes the knee. And the meus is a Harry Potter sounding flourish at the end. So we've got gastrocnemius, the belly of the knee. Now onto my favourite muscle, which is sartorius. Also happens to be the longest muscle in the body, and it stretches all the way from the knobbly bit at the front of your hip down across your thigh and onto the top of your shin. Now, sartorius has got a good story to its name. You see, the Latin is sartor, and sartor means tailor. And when you contract sartorius, it allows you to cross your knee and form the position that tailors would have been in when they were sewing up their garments. And we use it today in modern English. If you describe someone as being sartorial, then you're saying that they're very well dressed and might even have a tailor. So I hope from these couple of examples, you can see that the language of anatomy and learning about what's under your skin doesn't need to be intimidating and overwhelming. Think of the language less like the trappings of a J.K. Rowling novel and more of a fun foray into the English language. Thank you for listening, and may I finish by saying that you are all looking very sartorial this evening.
Kat, it's time for our judges' questions.
So, Kat, I love the language. I love the fact that we're learning about our bodies. But is it practically useful? I mean, you know, should we all now be ringing up the doctor and say, I've got a twinge in my sartorius or something? Or surely you just go in and just show them the bit. You don't really have to know what anything's called.
Absolutely.
Or am I being a philistine?
In a straightforward medical context, you would just say, I've got a bit of pain up here. But I think we all have a natural curiosity about our own bodies. And so a lot of times people, and I see this in students a lot, they are confronted with anatomy and it's the words that freak them out. It's not working with cadavers, which you might think would be the disconcerting bit. It's actually the words, and they just go, there's too many syllables, I can't learn this. And I say, just say it in the car or say it in public. You'll look nuts, but you've got to learn it. But if you can make a story for it or break down the word and actually give it some meaning, then people pick it up a lot faster. And it's just, I suppose, about inspiring just that natural curiosity and giving that a bit of a boost and saying, you can do this. There is no reason why you should let it hold you back, and you can make up some really fun stories.
I've comprehensively failed to learn any anatomy. I mean, it's the thing I find the hardest, and I wish there were more lecturers like you, actually. But I was just going to say, I guess there's a lot of different ways of communicating science, and there are a lot of different audiences for it.
Absolutely.
And I guess yours is the educational more. Mm-hmm. But is there a particular area of anatomy that you studied that, because one of the things I was thinking is you could have started with a quirk of anatomy and told a story about that.
I could
but
have.
But you used the language instead. So I was going to ask.
Absolutely. Yeah. There are lots of quirks. And one of the things I like to talk about in classes, and is especially important with medical students, is that we are all unique. There's a muscle in your wrist, which if you flex against resistance, the tendon will pop out. 10% of the population don't have this muscle. because it's evolved out. We call it Palmaris longus. Okay. And people love that. You go, oh, yeah, look, I'm more highly evolved. Yeah, look, yeah, I have one. I'm not highly evolved. Yeah. And people love talking about that and thinking about how unique they are. But I suppose this is a way of getting people that initial interest over. And once you can start thinking about the words, be like, oh, yeah, now I'm going to learn about all these unique quirks that people have got.
Okay, I think that's 2 minutes up. Thank you very much, Kat. Round of applause for Kat Sanders.
So, I don't know, I can't tell. It's time for contestant number 8, who apparently hails from across the pond, which around here is the Serpentine, so presumably from Marble Archway. We've got Dr. Kate Feller, who's a postdoc independent research fellow at Cambridge with a flair for the dramatic. Please welcome Dr. Kate Feller!
I'm really angry! This may be because I'm an inherently angry animal. I'm a mantis shrimp, but you're all intelligent people, so we can use my scientific name, stomatopod. Rolls off the tongue better, stomatopod. Say it with me, stomatopod. I have this huge pair of specialized appendages for spearing or smashing apart just about anything I find on the bottom of the ocean. Is this food? Whack it. Is this my enemy? Whack it. Is that guy trying to have sex with me? Whack it. Each whack of my hammer packs a lot of punch, 1,500 newtons of force to be exact, which is 1,000 times or more of my body weight. I can do this because my arm is spring-loaded, just like a crossbow. I slowly contract a muscle before pulling a latch right here, ding, to release my hammer, shoo, with speeds up to 83 miles per hour. If I were on the motorway, I'd get a speeding ticket. But I'm underwater, so the coppers can't catch me. My hammer moves so fast through the water that the water molecules don't have time to fill in the space. And so an area of low pressure forms and a cavitation bubble results. This bubble collapses a half a millisecond after impact, producing a second force, half that of the first, plus heat, sound, and light. It's just like Harry Potter's defense spell, Expelliarmus! Except I don't need a magical wand. Just physics. But there's more to my anger. And it's not just scientists who poke me with sticks, or living with sand in places not polite to talk about, or Donald Trump. I'm angry because my home, my beautiful, life-giving home, the coral reef, is dying. Forget about the thousands of species of fish and other neighbors I have. Coral reefs are home to the greatest number of stomatopod species on the planet. Just around one island in the Great Barrier Reef, there's more than 32 different species of my fellow stomatopod. Global climate change is causing sea temperatures to rise and corals to bleach, which is when their food-producing algae leave and the corals starve and die. Without the corals, me and my neighbors don't have a home, don't have food, and soon enough, we're not going to have anyone to have sex with. And it's all because of you, intelligent human beings with your modern way of life, your fossil fuels, carbon emissions. That's why I'm angry. And I hope you're angry too. Now please help fix it.
Dr. Feller! I hope your question's polite, because angry.
I hope you
two
can change
comes.
Your voice as well, because you're about to wreck your vocal cords, I think. On behalf of humanity, I apologise for wrecking your home. What is your specific research into? Is it in the
yes.
spearing action?
I do.
I am one of the scientists.
You're a mantis fiddler.
Yes, exactly. No, actually, I'm trying to understand the neurobiology of how they make how they release that strike. So, what is it as far as a sensory cue that sends a message through their nervous system to be like, oh, boink?
Do you put electrodes in their brains?
No, in other parts of their nervous system.
They've also got amazing eyesight.
They do. Actually, that's what my background's in, and I kind of eliminated it from this to focus on how cool their strike is.
But actually, it led to an important environmental
message. I also really wanted to have a quality message with this one, because there's a lot of terrible things happening right now, specifically in Australia and other coral reef systems. And we need to be aware of it, and we need to engage with our political systems and switch over to renewables. We need to participate in citizen science projects. We need to do something, because this is unacceptable. I'm choking up right now.
What is the one thing that people in the audience, ourselves and people in the audience, can take away that we should do tomorrow to start trying to attack this question?
Do tomorrow. Source everything you do locally. Just minimize the impact you have on the environment and the carbon emissions. If you can decrease your carbon footprint, that is the number one thing to... I mean, we have to combat this. This is a huge problem, not just for stomatopods, obviously.
Can you just say something in 20 seconds that's really cool about the neurobiology? Are they a model for you, or do you study...
So there's almost nothing known about them, so it's really fun because I'm doing very basic research and making up everything as I go along.
Well, I don't think I'd question anything you'd say.
That's the time up for the questions.
Thank
Give
you.
Kate a big round of applause.
So our penultimate finalist this evening is a marine chemical ecologist, taking part tonight to get leading science out of the labs and into our conversation. Please welcome and put your hands together for Dr. Mahasweta Saha.
Was kann ich heute Abend essen? Fish and chips oder Sushi? Nein, Fish and chips. Oh, what was that? Did I confuse some of you? I am sorry, I am stressed, confused, and forgot to use our common language, English. Let's switch to English. By the way, I was just planning my dinner tonight. Imagine, I have closed my eyes, ears, nose, and if I zip my mouth, all my senses are blocked. Forget dinner, forget science communication. I am lost. I represent a marine organism. Most of the marine organisms do not have eyes, ears, or noses. So how do they manage their day-to-day life? The tiny drifters in the ocean that are producing 50% of the oxygen you breathe. How will they find food, find a partner, make love, and produce babies? Well, they all use the common language infochemicals, information carrying chemicals. Chemicals are called the language of life in the sea. Even the ones that have eyes use chemicals. Finding Nemo was all about chemical communication. Disney made a lot of money, never acknowledged poor ecologists like me. Anyway, speaking of chemicals, there is a very special and highly important group of chemicals called the volatiles. Now, volatiles are everywhere. The bad breath in your mouth, volatile sulfur compounds. Dogs can detect explosives, cancer, by just smelling one single chemical. Maybe you have been attracted to your partner by the way he or she smells. And an albatross can detect an area packed with full of tasty fishes by just smelling one single chemical. DMS, dimethyl sulfide. Now, DMS is also an infochemical for many marine species. Now, with global change, this communication is getting disrupted. Pollution in the sea is interfering. Plastic pollution is a big problem these days. Plastics also emit DMS, The birds, fishes, think them to be food, eats and dies. So let's not pollute our environment. Let's protect our oceans. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Judges, your questions, please.
Thank you for a great story. Something that jumped out at me that you mentioned once or twice, but I don't think you really explained, you kind of tickled us with, were these infochemicals. And you mentioned about DMS and how it is used, but not really what it does. What information is communicated between organisms with DMS? Or a better example, if you have another one.
So you mean that how... So DMS is actually an infochemical, and then it says that whether food is available. So what happens, planktons and macroalgae, they are great source producers of DMS. And when the zooplanktons graze on them, so that gets released. And then the bird can detect this DMS. Penguins, also whale sharks, they can detect. And then they can detect that, okay, that's the productive area, and that's the place where I should hit upon, because they are really stressed, because they have to eat, find a really productive area, and go back to their home and feed their chicks and partner. So, yeah, that's how DMS acts as an infochemical.
So it's almost as if the algae are accidentally releasing the DMS, because it attracts predators and things that eat them.
So when the algae dies, that attracts, and also the predators can sense the algae, and then when they start the grazing activity, the gas gets released.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's always been a quest for human infochemicals in the form of pheromones.
Yes,
and
yes.
Over the years, when I was a Fleet Street hack, I wrote at least half a dozen, Quest for the Human Pheromone. Is that a load of old cobblers, or do you think, are we just too smart to fall for someone? Will it ever happen where I can dab something, you know, behind my ears and suddenly all the women in the audience will leap at me?
Actually,
I'm a bit desperate now. Happily married, I hasten to add.
We do react to all these infochemicals, but it's very unknowingly we do react, because mostly we respond through visual and ear. But like, there have been evidences where, like, a woman, she's on a menstrual cycle, so the other woman's menstrual cycle alters, and men usually tip exotic dancers more when they're in their cycle. So they do react, but they just don't know about it, and there have been studies published.
I'm afraid that's it. That is true as well. That's definitely. A round of applause, please, for Dr. Nasra.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor.
So it's now time for our finalist of the evening, who is a PhD student from Manchester, currently spending the last year of his PhD studying inflammatory brain disease. He's ready to nourish your neurons. He's Michael Daniels.
I have a problem. It's a debilitating disorder that affects a fraction of humans and almost all other mammals. This condition has plagued me almost all my life, but I won't let it dictate me. It's time it was out in the open. I can't handle spicy food. Yeah, that's right. I'm a curry coward, a pepper pessimist, a Scoville scaredy cat. Will all you norms out there brashly order your chef's special vindaloo? I'm the guy shamelessly ordering the korma. But you don't understand. No one understands. Until now. This is Capsicum annuum, also known as the bird's eye chili. And tonight, in the name of science, I'm going to sink my teeth into this thing and explain to you all what it does to me. Oh, jeez, am I doing this? Oh, the first thing that hits me is excruciating pain. That is all down to the active ingredient of the chili, capsaicin. As soon as it hits my mouth, capsaicin opens tiny gates called ion channels located in my nerve cells. Positively charged sodium ions flood through these gates, sending an electrical impulse shooting to the pain centers of my brain and signaling a red alert. But this isn't just any kind of pain. My mouth is on fire. You see, the ion channel opened by capsaicin, called TRPV1, is what we call a noxious heat receptor. Its job is to detect painful levels of heat, anything over around 45 degrees. Capsaicin can activate TRPV1 and open the tiny gates of pain no matter what the real temperature inside my mouth. This chili is literally tricking my mouth into thinking it's on fire. By now, I've got a fairly impressive shade of red, and I'm starting to sweat like Donald Trump in a CIA meeting. These two effects are both a result of that fake heat. My body is desperately trying to cool itself down by sending blood to my extremities and by opening sweat glands to lose heat through evaporation. But these two effects are all in vain. I'm trying to lose heat when I'm not even hot. I need to do something to stop the capsaicin in its tracks. Right now in the curry house, you may reach for that ice-cold, refreshing glass of water. But that would be a serious mistake. You see, just like the oil that floats on top of your curry, capsaicin does not dissolve in water, and drinking it will only make matters worse. Food or drink high in fat, however, such as milk, yogurt, or lassi, should help dissolve the capsaicin and neutralize its effects. But there is one more way to put out the fire. High-proof alcohols are also very effective at dissolving capsaicin. And so, to my fellow sufferers, next time you're in the curry house and that exotic dish turns out to be a little bit more fiery than expected, step away from the water and have a shot of vodka instead. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Michael. By the looks of the bottle, you rehearsed quite a bit. 2 minutes for questions, James.
That is a genuine hot chill as well, isn't it? Your eyes are streaming. For the audience that can't see, yeah. This man has not acted.
Come on, Lewis.
I'm the Indian judge.
Well...
This is the excuse for the vodka. Give me the vodka.
I do suffer from a debilitating disorder.
So, Michael, you mentioned how different people have different responses to the capsaicin and the peppers. Is there a genetic basis behind that? Have people looked into the neuroscience?
Yeah, there's
what's
been
going
twin
on?
Studies.
Are you looking into the neuroscience of what's going on?
So my research is on brain disease, like Alzheimer's disease, but I'm particularly interested in all forms of neuroscience and in ion channels. I did a lot of research in ion channels before, and there's been twin studies done on chilies, and there is some level of genetic kind of association, but it's only accounted for about 30%. So it's fairly limited. We still don't really know why humans are the only species that do this. No other species. Chilies have evolved. The whole point of chilies is so that mammals don't eat the plant. That's why it's hot, because they want birds to eat it. So birds, TRPV1, doesn't activate capsaicin.
Because the bird has a different temperature.
It's got a slightly different receptor. It's amazing. We only discovered this in 2002, so we've obviously known this for ages. We've only finally discovered, really, the difference in the bird's receptor. But there is some genetic carryover, but we don't really fully understand it yet.
I thought you were going to lead us to... I think there is a body of research showing there's a health benefit for capsaicin-rich foods, isn't there?
Yeah.
So there would be a benefit for you having a vindaloo rather than one of your wimpy cornbers or something.
That's a lot of the theories behind the benefits of capsaicin in terms of why hot foods are cooked in maybe sub-Saharan countries is because capsaicin has been antifungal properties. Mm. And so that's why they think that these foods have become so popular in areas like that, is because they can protect against infections.
Well, that's all the time we've got for questions. Let's give Michael another big round of applause. Thank you very much.
Final contestant of the night, and that does mean that, judges, you have a big challenge away from you. Luckily, you know how to cope with stress now, and there's a bottle of vodka on the way. So please gather your pens and papers. We'll have about 15 minutes to try and decide. This is your last chance, Adrian, to shout the name of your favourite to influence the judges as they walk up the stairs. So please shout it nice and loud. And also put your hands together for our wonderful judges as they go make their decision, guys.
So, audience. An important job awaits you also. You can vote as well. So while the judge is away, you are able to cast a vote for your favourite contestant. So up on the screen for the next 15 minutes, there will be the details of who you can vote for. You will need something called a smartphone. a smartphone. Everyone familiar with those? Yes? Yeah? No, some people are like, what? No.
I see one person playing Snake over there going,
this is not for me. So if you grab that out, you can log on to the Science Museum's free Wi-Fi. Or if you've got your own, you know, allowances, use that. You know, some people have got more than 2 gigs. Yeah? Go crazy. Please log on. You can see all the details up on the screen of how you need to vote.
Once you voted, you press next. It might, it will ask you or say next question, like there is a next question. There isn't a next question. Once you've clicked on the name, press next. That's your vote cast. The next question is hypothetical, I guess.
Or but how do I put my phone down?
Yes, probably. That could be,
something
yes.
like that. For the 15 minutes while the judges are judging, we are going to attempt to entertain you with some demonstrations of our own. Sam, what have we got?
So we've picked stuff that we like and we think is interesting. We've also picked things that, you know, we do a lot here at this museum for science communication-wise. We have more educational visits than any other place in the country, so we have lots and lots of kids coming in, and they ask a lot of similar questions, so we've got some good knowledge there we'll share with you in a bit. But first, we're going to go for one of John's favourite things to talk about.
Obviously, you're an intelligent audience, and you're pretty clever on the whole. You can agree with that if you like. No, you're a modest audience, and I like that. That appeals to me. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to just test your brains out just a little bit. So I've got some optical illusions. I call them optical illusions. They're not really optical illusions because that suggests it's your eyes that the problem, and it's not really your eyes. It's your brains. So we're going to have a look at the first one. So let's have a look at this. This is called floating rice. And if you look at that, it should appear like it's moving. Is that everyone sensing that? Yeah? You can talk if you like. It's called call and response.
They are busy voting as well, John. They are busy voting.
That's very important that you do that also. Sure. Look from your screen to the big screen and then back. this is a still image. This isn't moving. The thing that's making it move is your brain. Now, we're not exactly sure why this is the case. It could be because of the contrasting colours. It could be because your eyes have little micro adjustments that we're not even aware that we make. And we look at it, and it seems like it's moving, even though it's not, which is nice. This is fine. But we can move on. We can do better. Here's another one. Now, this is called a bistable image. And what we've got here is a 2D image masquerading as a 3D image. And your brain finds that very difficult to deal with because it hasn't got the new normal triggers that it would have in order to say what exactly is going on. So what you'll notice is if you look at it and carry on looking at it, and then look away and look back at it, then you'll notice the dancer might spin in a different direction. And just to check, who thinks the dancer is spinning from left to right? Put your hands up. Okay, who thinks the dancer is spinning from right to left? Yeah? Who's it changed for? Yeah? It's weird, isn't it?
And don't worry, it's not just you.
It's not just you. And it's not, we're not actually spinning it in any particular way. It's just the way your brain's trying to work out what the image is doing. What I was trying to work out is, by the way, I need to make this very clear. We did not make this image. This is not our image. And I'll make that clear because someone thought that they put the booby up there with a nipple on it. And that's just weird. It's just unnecessarily detailed. It's very, very sexist.
Not sure they ever thought it'd be on a screen this big.
No, but they've still done it. There's no need for that. I use the word booby, despite being a grown man.
Yeah. Well, there's the voting. Make sure you have a look at that again.
Have a look at that.
Keep looking. Pin or the website.
And here's our next image. Now, this does something slightly different. What I want you to do is I want you to look at the lady's nose and just concentrate at the 3 dots on the lady's nose and just carry on looking at that and don't look away. So it's very important you just stare at her nose And don't look at anything else, just concentrate on that, because what we're trying to do is we are trying to wear your eyes out. We're trying to make them a little bit tired, and what we want to do is just tire them out just enough that when you look at the white square over there...
I love that reaction. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
What's happened is your colour receptors in your eyes, they've got tired out, they've got worn out, and they've stopped sending the signal to your brain, because your brain's kind of, yeah, I've got the signal, yeah, that's fine, I can deal with that. So what happens is your other colour receptors go, hey, what about us? We can get in on this. We'll send some signals. And that's what they do. They send some signals, which is the reverse image to that lady up there. Okay. That's why... I think you shouldn't necessarily always trust your brains.
No. An optical illusion should be called neurological illusions.
No, just stick with that. Just confusing otherwise. Yeah, just, yeah.
Okay, so there's the voting stuff. Make sure you are looking at that.
Carry on voting.
But we are going to hijack the screen just one more time, because of all the amazing things we have here at the Science Museum, we've got some fantastic objects. Stinson's rocket. We're one of the only places in the world to have an Apollo capsule and a Soyuz. Very near. Whoa, yeah, one woo, well placed. No one else joined in though, it's sad. It's amazing, but of all the things and all the questions kids could ask and all the things they could ask about, what they could ask about propulsion and kind of the material and stuff, they always want to know, how do astronauts go to the toilet? It's what they always come back to.
Yeah.
So we did some research, we found some stuff out, and we have a video here of the NASA kind of positional training room, it's called, and this is how they train to use the toilet on the International Space Station.
So you can see there's a TV monitor here.
There's a TV monitor there.
There's a camera inside the hole.
That's correct.
You'll notice the hole here is 4 inches.
The hole is 4 inches?
Whereas a normal toilet seat is more like 12 or 18 inches.
What's a normal? You mean like the one you have in your house?
That's right.
All right.
The most dramatic toilet you'll ever see. So this and is not overly clean as well.
It's used by a lot of astronauts, John. A lot of music. And this is on the tour. You can go see this if you go to the tour. And there's a special lock they put on the door that sometimes apparently astronauts do forget. So sometimes they open the door to show you the room and it's being used and trained on. But I don't think you guys are quite getting it. The video might be a bit confusing. So we wanted to do a live demonstration.
What?
Here tonight.
What?
Yeah.
I think they've got it.
It's gone a bit. No, they haven't. They look confused.
We're on a video.
they look a bit confused. So we do need a volunteer. Someone want to come and help us with our positional training?
Wow. A sea of hands.
They're all being very polite. There's a hand. At the back. Round of applause for our volunteer all the way from over there. He's about to come down. What is your name?
Bobby Seagull!
Wow! It's Bobby Seagull. You don't know who Bobby Seagull is, do you?
This guy.
You don't watch University Challenge, do you?
No.
Who watches University Challenge here? Yeah. You totally should have beaten Monkman.
I remember seeing the name now.
Yeah. But you're from... Sorry, we're just going to turn this into a Bobby Seagull interview now. You're from Ilford, right?
Yeah. East
Ham. You see, because I'm a Romford boy, you see, so we're pretty close. No.
That's the line of questioning you've gone for.
Well, you know, local boys. Okay, Sam, your demo.
Okay, do you need the toilet currently? No, that's okay. Nobody ever does.
I know what's coming. I feel bad. We shouldn't do this to Bobby Seagull.
Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to have this. It's going to be our toilet. Been a bit generous with the aperture here. That's going to be our toilet. We don't have a camera like they do where they look at the camera, look at the team screen, the camera coming out the toilet. So you guys are going to act as our camera, if that's okay. And what we're going to do is we're going to have Bobby Seagull is going to look the other way. You guys are going to shout instructions left, right, back, and then we'll give you 5 seconds when you will shout stop, and then you just need to poo, okay? hopefully into the...
Okay, perfect.
Okay, now... No, so you still really don't need to go. You couldn't? No? Have we got that Daniel had the thing that makes you poo earlier.
Yeah, yeah. Just crank it right up.
Yeah. What we'll do is we'll have a simulator poo here, this muffin here. So if you could face the other way, please, Bobby. Thank you very much. And just hold this like a kind of bunny tail.
It'd been so highbrow up until now.
There we go.
So sorry.
I'm going to move the toilet to make it... I mean, this is the kids. We do this for the kids, OK? he's not looking. OK, we're going to move this to make it harder.
That's exactly the same spot.
Don't tell him. OK, so, Bobby, please don't look the other way. We'll give you... We've got a clock there. We'll give you 5 seconds. Ladies, be very... ladies and gentlemen, be very clear in your instructions. And go!
What?
It's time to poo.
now, Bobby, you're officially the least popular astronaut on the ISS now, because you have missed the target that's floating around.
But this is a solid one.
It is solid. It is solid. Yes, that's the good news.
It's solid. Ladies and gentlemen, please, round of applause for Bobby. Thank you very much.
So sorry. Oh, that was really underused, Bobby Seagull there.
Hi there, Bobby.
In other
news, from Milford, right? Are you from Milford?
Look, that? I'm from Romford. That's the best we can do. Is anyone else in from Romford? Yeah. Just that's all we get. These.
Yeah. I'm also from Romford. Yeah, it's nice. Yeah, it's all right, isn't it? Yeah.
I don't live there anymore. I've moved on. Moving on. It's time. It's Bobby Seagull. My wife is not going to believe this. Genuinely excited. Sorry, Sam.
Next up, we're going to have a look at a little bit of geometry.
Oh, are we?
Geometry, and we're going to need. I think we might see Bobby again, because we're going to need volunteers. John, and 4 of them this time. We do need people, very importantly, that don't have any kind of back problems, who aren't pregnant. This is a weird way to find out if you're here with your partner. You love stuff like this. Have a go. I can't. So if we could have 4 volunteers of a healthy nature to come on down, that would be wonderful. We have one here. Fantastic. We'll take both of you guys. Fantastic. And anyone else? Anyone else? Bobby, anyone else? Bobby, anyone else? Bobby, anyone else? Bobby? Bobby's coming down again. There we go.
Let's have a ripple of applause for everyone there.
Round of applause for all our volunteers.
A little man heavy, I have to say.
A little bit.
It's fine. Okay, all
right. No one actually putting their hands up.
No, okay. Well, that's how that's worked.
Hi, guys. What's your name?
I'm Gabriel.
Gabriel?
Chris.
Thomas, this is Bobby.
Bobby, Bobby's famous. Rest of you don't really care about.
That's so nice. We do need to quickly set this up because we're going to talk about. We're going to show a very strong structure. The Greeks studied a lot of geometry, and that's why some of their buildings are still standing. They are really into their shapes, their strong shapes, and we're going to do that here. But instead of using materials such as marble or wood, we're going to use these guys here, hopefully. We've done this a few times. It doesn't always go right. But we'll be fine as long as we look after Bobby. okay, what we're going to do, guys. Gabriel, if you could please sit on this facing the screen, please.
So if you have 4 chairs and 3 other friends, you can try this at home. Now...
So if you could sit on this chair facing that way. It's starting to click, and then Bobby, if you can sit on this way, facing me, please.
What we're going to do is we're going to make a structure out of people here. Hopefully it'll work. Like Sam said, it didn't the last 12 times we tried it.
13th time's a charm.
Yeah.
Lucky 13.
Yeah. So what we want you to do is we firstly introduce yourselves to each other. That's good.
Bobby,
yeah. All right, let's not milk it. All right. Right, we need you to lie down on each other's laps.
Keep your feet firmly on the floor, if that's okay.
Yeah, no, what the hell are you doing?
Super casual over here. Can you get your feet on the floor? Try and get your whole
right.
Feet kind of...
Right, feet have to be on the floor.
Kind of shoulder width apart. There we go. That's
okay.
Gabriel, okay, you might need to shuffle a little bit towards Bobby, if that's
and if,
right.
And if possible... If possible...
When we do this, when we manage to get kind of male and females together, they don't do that. There's no...
No.
Get it!
Now, if your hands in the middle, if you could just take them and sort of grab onto each other... Because that will be structural.
Moral and structural.
There we go, that's good.
Okay.
And by holding your hands there, you've legally agreed not to sue the Science Museum afterwards. Kind of how that works.
Just a bit, I think if you can manage to shuffle back a little bit and you can... Close your legs slightly, please, sir. not that sort of show. Glad you're facing that way. Okay. There's some top bants going on here.
Yeah.
You can't quite hear. It's wonderful. So we are going to start putting chairs up. You guys, you might need to raise your cores slightly for us to quickly get them out.
Oh, wow. They're already doing it.
Yeah, okay. Here we
Let's go.
Let's go. Getting the chairs out.
Oh, steady. He's weakening and.
Give it up, Bobby!
And no one died! For the first time ever, no one died!
Give
our volunteers a massive round of applause. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bobby.
That was incredible. Oh, another massive round of applause. They made a human structure there. Come on. It's impressive stuff. And it was Bobby Seagull again! okay, Sam. So that was from a math show that we did for kids, which was nice. We do lots of shows here for the Science Museum for Kids. Sam, you're going to show another experiment from a kids show. What's the kids show called?
This show is called Super Cool. It's about heat.
Because that's what the kids say, is it? Super cool.
Yep. The kids think it's super cool. All the Fonzies turn up. It's a good title.
Yeah.
Okay. So this show uses liquid nitrogen.
People love it, don't they?
Casual iron. That's what I do when I'm casual.
Yeah, really.
Get my paraphernalia.
Thinking about it, I could probably just have got this stuff for you, Sam, but, you know, I'm looking at the clock. We have to keep it going.
I've realised we have forgotten something. Need some water. Some water. You might have to steal the judge's water. I'm sure they won't mind. They're up there sipping wine now.
Don't tell them. Just don't mention it. This will be fine.
Okay. So it does take a bit of a setup. So what we're going to do is we're going to finish. Hopefully the judges would have made up their minds. We're going to finish with a little bit of a bang. If you could pour some water in there, please.
Oh, yeah, can do that, yeah.
We're going to pour some liquid nitrogen into this bottle. It's going to start kind of already kind of going into the air. It's going to start becoming a gas. We're going to put it in the water. It's going to speed up that process. It's going to fill up. And we're going to end with a wonderful, wonderful explosion.
What?
A wonderful, wonderful explosion.
Oh, right. See, I don't... This is not one that I tend to get involved in, so where should I stand?
It's been a few years since I've done this, so...
Really?
Yep. I should have told you that, John.
Wow.
You stand just really close to me.
I like the way you've put the splash screen just anywhere.
There we go.
Those banners are expensive.
So, here's our liquid
nitrogen. I might move this.
Yeah, thank you. Can you put it behind the splash screen if that's okay?
All right.
I'll pour some of this out for you. You can see the lovely effect.
The splash screen's there! They're there!
It's fine. Sorry about the carpet, guys. here we go. So we're going to pour it in here, and I'm going to pour for quite a while because it will start to boil, and it's already going to go into the air. So we pour quite a lot to collect a little bit.
So, fans of temperature, it's minus, minus 196 degrees.
Where are my temperature fans at?
There's a few people wanted to know.
Yeah. Give it up for Kelvin. 77.15. Oh. There's not enough R in these days. Don't let me forget that.
Okay.
Okay, here we go. It's a bit where I have to take off the gloves. Put the balloon on top. So, I'm going to be wearing these ear defenders. You guys, good luck. Okay. This is going to make a bit of a bang, so please do make sure you have them on. For the people running my mic, you might want to think about that as well.
Although a technical point, and this is good for science communication, don't put your fingers actually into your ears. Not so good for bangs. Just put them over your ears, your hands over your ears like that. Tends to be better. Thanks.
Okay. Here we go. Balloon. On. Safety glove. Oh, please make sure your hands are over your ears.
They can't hear you.
Hands over your ears.
That's a good balloon.
We finished with a bang. What I really like, but you can see it's kind of kept its shape as it explodes. It's so cold. It looks quite beautiful. We'll be raffling this off after.
Okay, guys. Okay, that was good. Does it do anything else? Is that it?
Does what do anything else?
Does that do? No, so it's just that.
We were told the judges would be ready by now.
Okay, I mean that's fine. Anyone know any good stories? Anyone? Anyone know anything? Some jokes? Anyone? No? No? Okay.
I've not ever been able to do this. When I started Funk Science, I realised people kept going, oh, science comedy. Tell us a science joke. And I didn't have any, so I've written two.
Dear.
In 3 years, I've never got to say them in this room. So this is quite exciting. I'm going to revel in this. Get ready, Bobby. Strap in. Hey, okay, guys. What?
What?
I'm so happy. Right, no. Okay, guys.
You know the judges are here now.
Yeah. They can wait. this is important to me. I'll just tell one. Who's the most optimistic man in science? Thank you for asking. It's Kelvin, because he just doesn't deal with negatives. Come on! There we go.
Sam, take the hint, they didn't like it. Okay, I don't want to keep them waiting, but I really want to hear the second one.
What food has the most energy? Fish and chips. Yeah, should have kept with that last one.
It's the wrong order. And on that note, please welcome back to the stage the judges!
So,
hopefully there weren't too many arguments between the judges.
It was a very, very close competition.
Incredibly high standard, actually. Incredibly impressive. So, not easy.
Okay. Well, we'll come back to you in a moment. Before we do that, we have to thank a few important people that have helped to make the FameLab competition continue each year. First off, the very many FameLab partner organisers at local heat level, of which the Science Museum was one. The Cheltenham Science Festival, they're the creators of FameLab. Also the British Council, the international partners of FameLab overseas, and particularly tonight, EDF, for their continued support of the competition in the UK.
Okay, without these people, there would simply be no FameLab. And tonight, to help us with the announcements and to announce the winner of this UK final, we have Head of Communications for EDF. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Bob Fenton.
Thank you very much, Bob. Thank you, Bob. Would you like to say a few words for us?
I'll be very brief because I can't follow those 3-minute masterpieces. Even though my job is talking to people, I'm not going to try. I'm just going to say it's fantastic to be in the Science Museum. It's a brilliant venue, and I was talking to my colleagues earlier, and I said every time I come here, I revert to being the 12-year-old schoolboy I was when I first came into this place. It's a brilliant honour for us to be involved with FameLab. It's a tremendous competition, and we're immensely proud of it. We love every second of it.
Thank you very much, Bob. Thank you. So, our judges are back. You have the audience envelope, I believe, as well.
I have got the audience vote winner. Do you want me to give it to you? Or?
No, we'll let you answer, but first, can we please have all the finalists up on stage with us? Ladies and gentlemen, please do put your hands together for the reason we're here. Our 2017 finalists! So, I think we can agree, incredibly high standards, some really fantastic talks. Unfortunately, there can only be... I'll run up an audience vote winner and our grand winner. So, judges, could you please give the announcement for our runner-up this evening?
And the runner-up.
If it's La La Land, something's gone. Something's gone seriously wrong.
And the runner-up is Carol Glover.
Well, it's just been a really great experience, and meeting everyone's been amazing, and everyone's been a good night. So, thank you.
Big round of applause for Dr. Carol there. Thank you very much, Carol.
Okay, so hopefully you guys all got very busy during that kind of interval voting. So can we please now have the audience vote winner?
Well, that's me. And the audience vote winner is Callum.
Thank you very much to the audience, obviously. I think a row about there is pretty much all my
friends. Give another round of applause to Callum, our audience vote winner. So it is time for the main winner of FameLab UK to be announced, and that is over to you, Bob, to do the honours, please.
Okay. One envelope, hopefully only one name in it.
Moonlight.
I've not seen it, so I can't see it. But I can come in here. The winner is Alex Lathbridge.
You'd like a rap acceptance speech?
Okay, what I will give you is... my girlfriend, she asked me, Alex, what will you do, you know, when you don't win? I guess we'll never know.
Congratulations, Alex. Very well done. Congratulations to everyone. Let's give them all a big round of applause. Alex, you're off to the Cheltenham Science Festival to represent the UK in June against 31 other national finalists.
Yeah, don't think too much like Eurovision, though. Even if both competitions do centre around, 3 minutes on stage against an international medley of fellow competitors, the odds of the UK doing well in FameLab are a lot better than the odds of us doing well in Eurovision, especially recently. So best of luck in June. Please do us all proud for the UK. At the Cheltenham Science Festival.
And if you would like to head along to the International FameLab final at the Cheltenham Science Festival, it's taking place on June the 8th. Don't think anything else is happening that day. Nothing important.
There'll be an audience certainly, doing this as well.
Certainly not vote-wise. So tickets are on sale now via the Cheltenham Festival's webpage.
Okay, so all that is left to say is, first of all, a big thank you to you guys, the audience here at the Science Museum IMAX Theatre. Also, you guys watching on Facebook Live at the moment. It's kind of your continued support of this and your continued interest in science that is exactly what FameLab is for. So thank you so much for coming. And also, please, one last time, put your hands together for our wonderful contestants, our wonderful judges, to EVF for their continued support, and the Cheltenham Festivals for their organisation of the competition. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and good night.